Okay, Shalom, Shalom, Kwam Yasahala, Koholoimla, Yahweh Bashim Yahushai Bahashim, Rekha Hakadash, double honors to our apostles and elders, a great millstone who rule well, and that by the Spirit taught us this beautiful truth, and just want to say the water toward the Akim and Akwath. That's all here sincerely, keeping the laws, the statutes, and commandments of Yahweh Bashim Yahushai to the best of their ability. Jachanan Nawaf. It's coming at you with another quick lesson, praying that it's edifying by the Spirit. And ran across this this article with this 83-year-old woman, right? And I you have to Google some of this stuff sometimes. Sometimes you'll see a story, and you won't, you know, they don't give you like a, not that we go by colors of people's skin, but sometimes it can help, you know, to a certain extent, you know what I'm saying? But when you hear certain stories, you just kind of figure, all right, this is some so-called white people. Where if you hear, you know, certain things, you'd be like, oh, but it's so-called black people. It's just like it's like a spirit that's on the different nationalities of people where you just kind of, you can tell who it is as soon as you hear the story almost. So it says, woman 83 dies after falling 48 feet down a hidden well shaft in a century-old South Carolina home. So century-old, you're looking at about, you know, I think around the 1920s or something like that. She's 83. She's most definitely old enough to have, you know, been taken apart and being very cruel to so-called blacks, Hispanics, or Native Americans, you know, around her childhood age or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Those houses, a lot of the times they go back, you know, as far as, you know, slavery, so to speak, you know. But, you know, this is just me speaking as a man when it comes down to this, because this is a treacherous, terrible way to die. But let me get this scripture real quick. And it just made me kind of just think of, like, you know, by the Spirit, how terrifying the Lord is, man. And people don't respect it. People don't respect how terrifying the Lord is, man. Let me come back to this. I know where it's at. I just want to stay here, though. I didn't put an M right. But anyway, matter of fact, you know what? Let's just go into it. Hebrews. And it says, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And you know how fearful it's got to be. Let's just get to some of the story. Because she's just walking in her house, walking in the kitchen, and fall through the floor down an old-ass well that she, you know, they didn't even know was in the house. It's just, I mean, you can't make this type of judgment up, man. I mean, it's crazy. Salem, South Carolina. An 83-year-old woman who died when she fell through rotting floorboards in the century-old South Carolina house and down a well shaft the owner didn't know was there. Okay, so this is not a childhood home of hers, I guess. It says it took rescuers nearly 4 hours Sunday to get to the woman's body, to get the woman's body out of a nearly 50-foot deep hole. The victim was identified by the coroner as Dorothy Louise Downey, okay? She was helping her daughter pack up and move from the house in Salem, which according to the property records was built, okay, yep, 1920. As she walked across the kitchen floor, part of it collapsed. The woman's daughter searched for her in the crawl space under the house and couldn't find her. According to a police report, firefighters finally were able to find the woman and bring her back to the surface, said the coroner, who determined she died from injuries from the fall. Downey fell approximately 48 feet to her death. Can you imagine that? That's like, you know, that's like something out of nowhere. Addis declared the death an accident and said he has never seen a death like this in the 31 years. Of course you've never seen a death like that, you know, because, hey, the Lord is creative, man. The Lord, it's so many ways that the Lord has knocked off people in the Bible, man, that people just really don't get it, you know, because Christianity, they teach this love, love, love. He loves everybody. He loves everything. Come as you are. He loves you. But, man, you know, you have to realize a brother mentioned it like 2 nights ago. I was watching a lesson. I can't think who it was. It was one of the GMS camps, though. But he mentioned something that I had never thought of before. He was talking about the flood. And he was like, the Lord saved more animals than he did humans. And I was like, oh, whoa, that's cold. Because he did. He only saved 8 people. Noah, his 3 sons and their wives, you know what I'm saying, which was 8 people in all. But, you know, of course, the boat was filled with animals. You know what I'm saying? So we talking about a power that killed off everybody on the planet, man, for their wickedness. And that's coming again in his second death. You know, not to say that he's going to, you know, kill off everybody like he did with the flood. You know what I'm saying? Because they're going to be still people. They're going to be, you know, going to be still alive. But, you know, places like America, which is Babylon the Great, is going to be totally destroyed. You know what I'm saying? But there's going to be people that are going to be still, that's going to not, you know, everybody is not going to die by this fire that's coming, so to speak. But anyway, so when I thought about that, let me get this numbers, right? This situation where the Lord actually swallowed somebody up, a whole family. Go to the book of Numbers. But this is just, you know what I'm saying, just to give you an idea of how cold the Lord is, man. Numbers chapter 16. Let's get to the point here. Let me see. Okay, so let me see. Let's get some of the content of, you know, what was pretty much the argument. Let me see. The argument was pretty much, see, and this is why it's so important to chill on, you know, just, you know, talking about the men of the Lord and having, you know, a certain type of, you know, harboring a certain type of feeling in your mind and heart, you know, about the men of the Lord, you know, just, hey, let it, you know, and this is why a lot of people get judged. Let me see. So they're fussing, basically. Let me see here. I want to get to the point that I'm fussing and I'm just jump straight to the judgment. Let's just see from the top here. Salakia. Korah's rebellion, right? Let me just start from the top here. It says, now Korah, the son of Izhar, the son of Kohath, the son of Levi, and Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, and on the son of Peleth, sons of Reuben took men, and they rose up before Moses with certain of the children of Israel, 250 princes of the assembly, famous in the congregation, men of renown. So these are, you know, well-known men in Israel at the time, 250 or so of them. And they gathered themselves together against Moses and against Aaron and said unto them, ye take too much upon you, seeing all the congregation are holy, every one of them, and Yahweh is among them. Wherefore then lift ye up yourselves above the congregation of the Lord Yahweh. So basically they're pretty much coming up against order. They're coming up against the way that the Lord set things up. You see, you can't force your hand when it comes to this truth, man. You know what I'm saying? You can't force it. You know, a lot of people are forcing their ways into positions because they want to be, you know, basically they just want to be known in a sense. You know what I'm saying? They want that stardom, so to speak. You know, they want that recognition, so to speak. So you had to chill and wait until the Lord brings you up. And so these men were trying to force that. But let's get to the punishment, though. Let's see how the Lord actually done them. Let me see. I'm going to start at verse 23. It says, And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the congregation, saying, get ye up from about the tabernacle of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. And Moses rose up and went unto Dathan and Abiram, and the elders of Israel followed him. And he spake unto the congregation, saying, depart, I pray you, from the tents of these wicked men, and touch nothing of theirs, lest ye be consumed in all their sins. So they got up from the tabernacle of Korah, Dathan and Abiram, on every side. And Dathan and Abiram came out and stood in the door of their tents, and their wives and their sons and their little ones. And Moses said, hereby ye shall know that the Lord Yahweh hath sent me to do all these works, for I have not done them of my own mind. See? And Moses was meek. It says, if these men die the common death of all men, basically if they, you know, kind of, you know, just live out their lives, so to speak, or, you know, some, you know, might you know, die from an accident, or, you know, basically, you know, or he's laying down and he just doesn't get up. You know, he dies of old age, so to speak, or whatever. That's, you know, like a common death. It says, or if they be visited after the visitation of all men, then the Lord have not sent me. So basically, Moses is like, you know, hey, if these guys die a regular death, you know, then, hey, the Lord didn't send me. You know what I'm saying? I'm a fraud. You know, I'm a false, whatever. Okay. But check it out. Verse 30. It says, but if Yahweh make a new thing and the earth open up her mouth and swallow them up with all that appertain unto them, and they go down quick into the pit, then ye shall understand that these men have provoked the Lord. And it came to pass, as he had made an end of the speaking of all, and it came to pass, as he had made an end of speaking all these words, that the ground clave asunder that was under them, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, and their houses, and all the men that appertained unto Korah, and all their goods. They and all that appertained to them went down alive into the pit, and the earth closed upon them, and they perished from among the congregation. Boy, man, the Lord called, man, gives you chills, boy. I'm reading this with chills right now. It says, in all Israel, now check it out, though, still, these niggas were still complaining. It says, in all Israel that were round about them fled. Shalakia, they fled. And all Israel that were round about them fled at the cry of them, for they said, lest the earth swallow us up also. And there came out a fire from the Lord and consumed 250 men that offered incense. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speaking to Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, that he take up the censers out of the burning and scatter thou the fire yonder, for they are hollow. Okay, so going on into, let me see here. So the Lord, he consumed all those people that was talking shit against Moses and Aaron, right? But now, let me see, I think it's, is it the next chapter? Oh yeah, no, same chapter. Verse 41. But on the morrow, so the next day, right? All the congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron, saying, ye have killed the people of the Lord. See? So they still don't have sense enough. They seen what the Lord done to them clowns. And they don't have sense enough to shut the fuck up. It says, and they were gathered against Moses and against Aaron, that they looked towards the tabernacle of the congregation, and behold, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord Yahweh appeared. And Moses and Aaron came before the tabernacle of the congregation, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, get you up from among this congregation, that I may consume them as in a moment. And they fell upon their faces. So Moses and Aaron, you know, they fell on their faces, you know, basically begging the Lord. And Moses said unto Aaron, take the censers, put fire therein from off the altar, and put on incense, and go quickly into the congregation, and make an atonement for them, for there is wrath going out from the Lord. The plague has begun. Woo. Hey, the Lord told him, I'm gonna give them some business too. And Aaron took as Moses commanded and ran into the midst of the congregation. And behold, the plague was begun among the people. And he put on the incense and made an atonement for the people. And he stood between the dead and the living, and the plague was stayed. Now they that died in that plague, in the plague, were 14,700 besides them that died about the matter of Korah. See that? So the Lord is cold, man. So don't let nobody get to telling you about how the Lord, he just loves, he loves, he loves, he loves. Hey, look, man, our Father is Scripture talks about how he's terrifying among men. When you see people die, when you look at the news, or say a family member of yours, anybody that could be listening to a lesson right now, you know, we all know somebody that kind of caught the business in a serious type of way, or maybe not, you know, if you're younger, but if you've lived longer, some stuff about, you know, you know, an attribute of the Lord, you know what I'm saying? Like, this lady is 83 years old. She's just walking in this house in the kitchen. I'm sure they, you know, people. That was literally, that was pretty much her, you know. You had to realize that was from the beginning of time. That well was set up for her to die in the 1920s. We need to have. Deuteronomy 32 and 39. See now that I, even I, am he, and there is no God with me. I kill and I make alive. I wound and I heal. Neither is there any that can deliver out of my hand. See that? The Lord is the one that set her up like that. And that's a cold way to go. That's a cold way to go. You just regular day, walking along, packing damn dishes up or something. She was probably in there packing up. You know, putting damn old ass newspaper around you know, some damn teacups or something. Probably went back to get another batch of drip. Honey, we got some more, you know, whatever, some more newspaper. And who knows? That's just me speaking, but man, come on, bro. You can't tell me the Lord. Shall a trumpet be blown in the city and the people not be afraid? Shall there be evil in a city and the Lord have not done it? See, hey, the Lord is letting you know right there, like, hey, that bad thing that happened to her, I done it to her. And the Lord is no respecter of persons. He doesn't care how old you are. You can be an infant. Hey, it's pregnant women that the Lord knock off with the baby in stomach. Sometimes the baby will make it and the mom won't, you know. Sometimes he'll take out both of them. Just before she about to give birth. On the day of her birthday type of deal. You know what I mean? Hey, the Lord is cold, man. But anyway, let me see. It was another one I wanted to grab that came to mind too. Let's go to, let's get an account in Joshua of the Lord getting down, man. See, a lot of, you know, I know brothers, one of the elders down in Mississippi, he always do these judgment videos. You know, it's just that brother's been kind of touching on a lot more of the prophecies of, you know, the other prophecies and stuff like that. So, you know, the business of judgment hasn't really been, you know, I haven't been seeing too many videos on judgment because normally I do them myself. But, you know, it's just, you know, it's been other things going on. But we still have to, you know, hey, let people know, hey, look, the Lord not playing no games. Now, this is Joshua, right? The book of Joshua. This is when, you know, they basically, you know, had to come out of Egypt and all that good stuff like that. They moving about, you know what I'm saying? Going to, you know, pretty much take some land, take all this land and stuff. But let's get to the point. Okay, so let me see. So they basically, let me see from the top here. Let's see. Israel is defeated at Ai, right? So Israel goes out to this war and it gets defeated. Now, mind you, they've been rocking out. The Lord been with them. It says, but the verse one, it says, but the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerai of the tribe of Judah, took the accursed thing, and the anger of the Lord Yahweh was kindled against the children of Israel. So see, that's how you know that we're a body, you know what I'm saying, a people as well. You know, and, you know, I mean, it's a scripture that talks about, suffer not, what is it? Let me see here. Salaki, I can come back to this. It's basically that, that scripture that, you know, these Christians, they be trying to use, loving thy neighbor. Let me see if I can find it real quick. trying to think how it's worded. So, Lockie, bear with me real quick. Oh, yeah, Leviticus 19 and 17. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thine heart. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him. So we're a people that's supposed to rebuke our people and let our people know. See, you have Christianity done taught us that we can't judge, you know. You can't judge me. Only God can judge me. You know what I'm saying? With that Tupac shit. But there was a time where we cut into each other, like, because it was a it was out of love. And actually, if we allow one of our, say, for instance, you allow one of your family members to do some shit and they just, and you're not saying anything about it and they continue on doing it, that would destroy you. You know, it can destroy you. Say, for instance, I'm just going to, let's just say, for instance, a little example. I'm just going to make something up. Say, for instance, and this happens every day on a day-to-day basis. You got a nigga in the house. He's growing up. Nobody's checking him. You know, he's getting into trouble. He's getting into fights at school. He's getting into things on the streets. Everybody on the block. He's fighting everybody on the block. And then all of a sudden, you know what I'm saying? You know, he gets his ass whooped or he gets killed or he gets hospitalized. Really, you know, when something happens to him real bad, then everybody wants to cry. But there could be, you know, it's a lot of people that have lost their lives because of a person that's in the household. You know, that nigga, he dealing dope. He messing with, he's robbing niggas. Now, people know where he live at, but you got your family in the house. You got sisters and brothers in the house. You may have grandmama in the house. You may have granddaddy in the house, somebody on a damn ventilator in the house, somebody in a wheelchair in the house, the elderly. You know, you a family in the house together, and you got this clown. He running throughout the streets, you know, fucking with everybody. And everybody know, I'm going to shoot this nigga house up. Now, all of a sudden, you know, people in the house get to business. You know what I'm saying? The damn house get burnt down, whatever the case may be. You know, it happens on a day-to-day basis. Why? Because nobody checked this nigga. And that's pretty much what this scripture is kind of going into. Leviticus 19 and 17, again, it says, thou shalt not hate thy brother in thine heart. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy neighbor and not suffer sin upon him. So you're supposed to rebuke your neighbor. So let's go back to this. So when I was reading this right here, the Lord was getting, you know, he got down on us as a nation of people. We went into slavery as an entire nation. It wasn't just like, you know what, them couple of bad niggas right there, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to send their asses into slavery, you know, and the rest of Israel going to be good. No, all Israel went into slavery because nothing was being checked. It wasn't being checked from the top, so to speak. You know what I'm saying? It was, you know, people, you know, they was allowing sin to run rampant. They wasn't, you know, like, carrying out the laws against those bad things so that that sin could be cut off at the, you know, that cancer could be cut off at the root, so to speak. And they let the cancer grow. And then it got so bad to the point where the Lord just like, man, the whole head is sick. You know what I'm saying? So that, yeah, I just wanted to bring that out. That's an example in a sense. But let's read on. Right. OK, so they lost this this war. Let's see why. What happened? Let me just continue reading. Verse 2. And Joshua sent men to Jericho, to Ai, which is beside Bethaven, on the east side of Bethel, and spake unto them, saying, go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai, and they returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go and smite Ai, and make not all the people to labor thither, for they are but few. So, you know, they looking like, man, hey, we could take these niggas. We don't even need that many people for this one. So there went up thither of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. Okay, so now they went up, they figuring they can handle this. You know, this should be easy work. But they fled, right? It says, and the men of Ai smote of them about 36 men, right? For they chased them from before the gate even unto Shabarim, and smote them even and smote them in the going down. Wherefore the hearts of the people melted and became as water. Right. And Joshua rent his clothes and fell to the earth upon his face before the ark of the Lord Yahweh until the eventide, he and the elders of Israel, and put dust upon their heads. And Joshua said, alas, O Lord God, wherefore hast thou at all brought this people over Jordan to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us? Would to God we had been content and dwelt on the other side of Jordan. So he's asking the Lord, well, you know, what's popping? What happened? It says, "O Lord, what shall I say when Israel turneth their backs before their enemies? For the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land shall hear of it, and shall environ us around, and cut off our name from the earth. And what wilt thou do unto thy great name?" So he like, man, hey, these nations hear about this, they're going to run up on us. Because, you know, all they've been hearing about is the glory of the Lord. Them coming out of Egypt, them running through this place and running through them, and all these different nations being afraid, you know what I'm saying, of the Israelites because of what had basically happened, what the Lord done to Pharaoh in Egypt. Verse 11, check it out. It says, "Israel have sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them, for they have even taken up the accursed thing, and have also stolen, and dissembled also, and they have put it even among their own stuff." Let's read that in the NLT, the New Living Translation, man. Verse 11. "Israel has sinned and broken my covenant. They have stolen some of the things I commanded must be set apart for me. And they have not only stolen them, but have lied about it and hidden the things among their own belongings." Verse 12. "That is why the Israelites are running from their enemies." I'm still reading in the NLT. "That is why the Israelites are running from their enemies in defeat. For now Israel itself has been set apart for destruction." See this? All because of one nigga. "I will not remain with you any longer unless you destroy the things among you that were set apart for destruction. Get up. Command the people to purify themselves in preparation for tomorrow, for this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Hidden among you, O Israel, are things set apart for the Lord. You will never defeat your enemies until you remove these things from among you." Verse 14. "In the morning, you must present yourselves by tribes. And the Lord will point out the tribe to which the guilty man belongs. The tribe must come forward with his clans, and the Lord will point out the guilty clan. That clan then come forward, and the Lord will point out the guilty family. Finally, each member of the guilty family must come forward one by one." Check it out. The one who has stolen what was set apart for destruction will himself be burned with fire along with everything he has, for he has broken the covenant of the Lord and has done a horrible thing in Israel. And here you have it. Early the next morning, Joshua brought the tribes of Israel before the Lord, and the tribe of Judah was singled out. So we know it's the tribe of Judah. It's somebody from the tribe of Judah. Then the clans of Judah came forward, and the clan of Zerah was singled out. Then the family of Zerah came forward, and the family of Zimri was singled out. Every member of Zimri's family was brought forward person by person, and Achan was singled out. So now we know who it is, this nigga. Then Joshua, Salakia. Then Joshua said to Achan, "My son, give glory to the Lord, the God of Israel, by telling the truth. Make your confession and tell me what you have done. Don't hide it from me." Achan replied, "It is true. I have sinned against the Lord, the God of Israel. Among the plunder, I saw a beautiful robe from Babylon, 200 silver coins and a bar of gold weighing more than a pound. I wanted them so much that I took them. They are hidden in the ground beneath my tent with the silver buried deeper than the rest." See this nigga, man? He got Jake, man. You got, see? 36 men got killed because of this clown, man. Joshua sent some men to make, and that's the reason why too, you know what I'm saying? Hey, the elders been going in real strong on brothers being, hey man, hey, you not doing what you're supposed to do. You know, we getting reports of you, you know, causing discord among brethren and, you know, all manner of stuff that you're not supposed to be doing. Hey, GMS, hey, they doing house cleaning. You got to go. Going out there, man, teaching your own, man, but you got to get up out of here. You're not going to cause the rest of the, you know, the congregation to get messed up, man. You know? Okay, so it says, "So Joshua sent some men to make a search. They ran to the tent and found the stolen goods hidden there, just as Achan had said, with the silver buried beneath the rest. They took the things from the tent and brought them to Joshua and all the Israelites. Then they laid them on the ground in the presence of the Lord." So you got to imagine how those family members are feeling. You know what I'm saying? That lost family, you know what I'm saying? Sons. you know, uncles and things of that nature, dads, man, you know what I'm saying, that went, those 36 men that were killed, you know what I'm saying, you have to imagine those families, because, you know, hey, Jake, you know, had real compassion and heart about their families back then. You think Jake crazy about their family right now? Man, Jake was hardcore about their family back then. Okay, so it says, then Joshua and all the Israelites took Achan, the silver, the robe, the bar of gold, his sons, daughters, cattle, donkeys, sheep, goats, tent. Now look at all this shit he had. He had a lot of stuff. And everything he had, and they brought them to the valley of Achor. Then Joshua said to Achan, why have you brought trouble on us? The Lord will now bring trouble on you. And all the Israelites stoned Achan and his family and burned their bodies. Now, what did his family have to do with it? That was it. I mean, that was his seed. You see? So it's just, hey, it's one of them situations, man, you know, where the Lord got down. It says they piled a great heap of stone over Achan, which remains to this day. That is why the place has been called the Valley of Trouble ever since. So the Lord was no longer angry. So somewhere in the world today, it's a pile of damn stone somewhere with them niggas still under it, man. See? So, man, hey, look, man, the Lord is nothing to be played with, man. I'm just going to put it that way. But this right here, and I know that just the lesson just went a whole nother way. But this right here is just a perfect example of, you know, how the Lord will get down on you. Here you go. This lady is 83 years old. She dies after falling 48 feet down a damn well underneath a kitchen in a house that she ain't never even know about, nor the landlord didn't even know about it. I mean, that shit is like hitting the lotto of death. Straight up, man. So, you know, I just wanted to touch on that. But, you know, hey, keep in mind that there's judgment going out in the earth, man. And the Lord, he's judging people on a day-to-day basis. And there's going to be a lot of judgment that's going to go out soon in mass numbers, man. The Lord has no problems killing people in masses. That's happening throughout the earth right now. He's been doing that with earthquakes. He's been doing that with floods. He's been doing it with tsunamis. Or, you know, all different types of weather. He's been doing it with war. Look at over in Ukraine. Supposedly, if the numbers is right, you know what I'm saying? They're talking about like 500,000-600,000 men then got killed within this past year just from that war. Not going to even talk about the Russian side of it. And look at what's going on over in Israel and in Gaza. They're not telling you how many people, you know, because it's a lot of them Israelis, they're getting their asses knocked off too. But it's a lot of those Palestinians getting knocked off. So we're seeing deaths in the thousands, and not to mention just, you know, Esau with their school shootings, their damn drug overdoses, the suicides, the you know, just people just dying from earth. Just need new management, man, from underneath Esau, because it's just wicked as hell. It's so much wickedness here. But the Lord is getting ready to judge this place, man. So it's our time to awake out of sleep and to repent. You have to repent to the Father Yahweh in the name of his Son Yahweh Shai. Those are the true names of the Father and Son. It's real simple, man. But hey, man, you know, I just seen this story and wanted to touch on that, man. So with that, I pray that the lesson was edifying. Kwame Inshallah.